that is we expend energy directly. And here in this apical membrane, we have what kind of port?
Synport.
That's a synport. So what's going to happen is sodium comes in here, and is the glucose going to go the same way or the opposite way if it's a synport? Is it the opposite way or the same way?
Same
way. So what happens in this case is glucose comes in with every time that we bring in a sodium, we bring in a glucose with it. And glucose is really too big to get across the membrane, so we have to have another way to get it across here. And so what we do in this particular case is we'll use a different kind of transport. What's the name of this transport? It's what? Facilitate transport to get into the blood. That's a big deal. So we also, too, will have some excetras here. The excetra, ECT, I guess, excetras would be PO4, negative charges, SO4, negative charges, amino acids, negative charge, also urea, which is weird. And I'll talk about urea later. But keep that in mind, urea. Don't let me forget to talk to you about why this is urea here. Okay, so what flavor ions are going in? Are they cations or anions? What flavor anions are going in? Are they cations or anions? They are what?
Anions.
They're anions. So they're anions. Are we good with that? You guys okay? And so every time we move this positive, it attracts a negative. That's kind of a no-brainer. But having said that, what happens is this sodium doesn't stay like that. Instead, it binds with what? You guys just did the test on that. What's the sodium going to bind with in the blood?
Bicarbonate.
Not carbonic acid, but bicarbonate. Right? Mm-hmm. And those two are coming together is going to be sodium bicarb, right? Mm-hmm. You guys just did a test on it. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So is that an acid or a base that I'm pointing
base.
To? That's a base, so it's a weak base. Mm-hmm. So it's going to neutralize the acids. So far of what we've done on the first half of the PCT is we've moved a lot of goodies, particularly sugar and particularly anions, So urea will become an acid if it actually turns into uric acid. So it becomes an anion when it donates its hydrogen to solution to form uric acid. You guys know gout and all that other stuff you mentioned a while ago, right? Now, before we go any further, it's real important that everybody understand this before we go to the next step. Does anyone have any questions on that? Because I'm going to diverge from the book a little bit, but I want to make sure we're clear on this first. You guys good?
Yes.
Okay. So let's draw the same picture, and this will still be the first half of the PCT. Okay, first half of the PCT. OBK.
What does AA stand for?
So let's do the same diagram.
AP? Is that AP? Or is that AA? Oh, is that AP or AA? Right
so
here, by you.
This would be lumen. This will be AP or BM?
AP.
This blood vessel here will be a paratubular capillary. This cell here would be the first one half of the paratubular capillary. Okay? And so the first thing that happens actually is that, make this a little bit different. The first thing that happens is that what we've done is we've moved negative out of the urine, and we're going to essentially have negative showing up here. If I get rid of a bunch of negatives, what that's going to draw is another negative. So what's the big negative that's missing in this? What's the most common negative particle that you can imagine? Is what you just said?
Chloride.
Chloride. And you even said the anion form. Okay? How's it getting across? There's two reasons, there's two specific aspects of how chloride is getting across. What's the doubt?
Simple diffusion.
Simple diffusion. And is it trans or paracellular? It's between the cells, so it's paracellular. Let me do a little bit of printing on that. It's between the cells, right, guys? Like between psychology and science fiction, parapsychology. So that's a paracellular. Now, what also is going to kind of hopscotch there is that now we've got the sodium and the chlorine in there, and the sodium is already being locked up, right? So we're going to end up with what kind of deficit now? Are we going to move cations or anions? We're going to move cations. So other than sodium, we're going to move calcium, magnesium, potassium. All right, and there's one more. This is where we move. After we move those, chlorine is going to get in there too. And these will go transcellular. Okay, so we move a bunch of cations, and we move maybe a little bit too many, that will attract more chlorine. So chlorine will actually go through both ways, both transcellular as well as paracellular to get across. So it's, you have to kind of draw these out in sequence, or else you get really confused of who's on first, what's on second. Okay. Any questions on that? Do me a favor, and let's take out this one. I made a mistake. And let's put urea here. Urea gets put across too. But it's in the second half, it's not the first half. So that's about 65% of all the effort. Right there. Most of the ATP, most of the water. 65% of the water, and all the goodies. 65% of all the goodies are in those two diagrams. All right, so the next is the second half of the PCT. Draw it over here. Here's my big draw here, because I probably need a room. All So there's three processes that this does, right? This, the three processes of making urine is filter, reabsorb, and what's the last step? Filter, reabsorb, and what's the last step? Secretion, good. And I mentioned last time that I would only hold you for one secretion, and one is enough in this particular case. It gets really confusing when we start talking about secretions of other things. But the one that I said I promised you was hydrogen. Now, how we get rid of excess hydrogen when we're carnivores is to get rid of it by using the other end of it. Respiratory hydrogens are the result of CO2. CO2 has three sources. CO2 can be in the urine, dissolved, it can be in the blood, dissolved, or in the cells of the tubule itself. Now, I'd like to be able to put that here too, and I would, but it makes the diagram too scrunched. But CO2 is produced by these tubular cells. It will undergo what kind of movement? What kind of movement, guys? Simple diffusion. And this is funny. CO2 will combine with water to form what? H2CO3.
Yeah.
Wow, how did you know that,
right? I know.
Wow. And so what's the enzyme that drives it to the right?
Anhydrase.
Yeah. So the enzyme here is referred to as
anhydrase.
Carbonic.
Anhydrase.
Wow, you guys are great. Anhydrase. And that falls apart to what? H. And what's left over?
HCO3.
What charge?
Negative.
Negative. And it can't get through the membrane by itself. So how does it get across?
Simple
diffusion. Facilitated
diffusion.
Is this starting to look familiar?
Yeah.
So this HCO3 is derived from hydrogen secretion. That HCO3 didn't magically appear. It actually came from here. And the three sources of the carbon dioxide came from the blood, tubular cells, and in the urine. It was dissolved. We suck it up by simple diffusion, by keeping a very low concentration gradient, by combining it. If we combine it, we lose the CO2 as an independent source, so we maintain a real low concentration by tying it up as carbonic acid. Now, we have a problem here that's not finished, because we got this nasty go juice here. That's not good. So how do we get rid of that? Well, where's the sodium come from? Okay, so we have the sodium coming in from here. I just erased the other one because I don't need it. The sodium is coming in from here. Sodium is going to combine with the bicarbonate to form sodium bicarbonate. Ooh, that was interesting. Oh my gosh. That looks so bad. All right, that's less worse. You guys okay with that?
Sure.
Now, what we're going to do is actually, in this regard, is we're going to have what kind of port? Okay, so what kind of port would this be, Cindy?
That would be the antiport.
Okay, so sodium is coming in, and what's going out? What's going out?
Hydrogen.
Hydrogen goes out. It's in the urine. If you're a carnivore, if you like meat, you've got stinky pee. You've got stinky poo. Stinky poo. Okay? I like that. So, having said that, as a carnivore, your blood pH would be 4.8. If you're a Vegemite, okay, your urine will be 8, right up about 8. Big difference, isn't it? That's a big difference compared to like our blood. What's our average blood pH? 7.1.
7.35,
right?
Yeah.
That's narrow. That's pixie dust. That's 10 billion fold. This is a lot more than that. It's a lot more than that. Okay, so that's in the second half of the PCT. I heard a question. Yes?
AM? Is it supposed to be AP?
Yeah, I put AM.
And then it's H2CO3, right?
H2CO3. Is she Miss Smart Pants?
Sure.
Yeah, no, because I'm human. Any other issues there? So we have first half, and I just want to reiterate that I am human. This belongs to the second as well. That second half, this is second half, please. I should put that right here, all the urine samples here from the last class. Somebody comes in the door. Okay. All right, so I think at this point it's best just to do the last diagram that you're required to know. And this is a real unique one. Let me finish this one. If I put, in this particular scenario, if I put a bunch of solutes on one side of the membrane, what's going to happen is that water is going to follow it. And so what are these guys? Aquaporin. So aqua means what material?
Water.
So how's it going across?
Simple
diffusion.
The water, this is going to get really salty here because I moved anions, I moved cations, I moved a lot of it. So water's going to follow that by the aquaporins. You guys have heard of aquaporins before, but a lot of people don't realize aquaporins are around all the time. We have some controlling aquaporins in the ascending loop with an ephon, but this is going on 24/7. It's always there. We have some aquaporins we can actually use on demand too. You guys cool with that? Okay, so let's do the last diagram, then we'll take a nice long break. I'll put that one right here because it's kind of music, goes sequentially. We're going to get out of the PCT now, and we get the loop and ephon. So what's the name of the loop and ephon that goes down? Yeah, the one that goes down is descending, the one that comes up is ascending. So this would be ascending loop of the nephron. And this would be our last item. I'll use the same color for me. It's not coming, I guess. So in each of these, this would be TJ's, right? TJ. Same thing here. TJ, apical membrane, basolateral. In this particular case, this blood vessel is no longer the proximal common tube, because we're at the proximal common tube. It's called the nasorectum. This will be the lumen. And here's what we have. We have a really unique situation. What kind of pump? Active for sodium. What kind of port?
Simport.
So we know that sodium is going to come across. and we'll actually have two chlorides come across. And what was the cation that also moved with sodium on the nerves? Yeah, potassium. I heard it.
Potassium.
Okay, now this is going to be weird. I promise you it will be weird. And it's right here. This is the weirdest of all weirds. What kind of channel?
Leaky channel.
Perfect. So the potassium gets pumped out using ATP, leaks back in. Sounds weird now. Hopefully it'll make sense. All right, so at this juncture, we're going to move water, lots of it. Lots and lots of water. Moving a lot of salts into the vasa recta, and the vasa recta is a real special blood vessel. The orientation is impossible to draw. The reason why is because if I were to draw this correctly, it would be a tube here, tube here, tube here, tube here, tube here. It doesn't really work too well. I probably should do that, but I'm just trying to follow as close as possible. But, so these tubes are actually going this way. Now typically, if you have a blood vessel next to this, it's going to be a flushing system. It's going to get rid of everything. That's what these guys do. They're picking up their goodies, and they're going to the other body parts. The reason why they do that is because these blood vessels move pretty fast. These blood vessels, oriented like this, super slow. They maintain the concentration within the kidneys. All right, so these help to maintain. This guy here goes slow-mo. Slow motion. Now, after I move that, I've got another issue. And the issue is this. That guy right there doesn't like to cross membranes easily. You have to do it with active pumps. But I've already put the active pump in here with the symporter here. But I need to get it across here. I've already expended the energy to create the gradient for a draw on an anion. But what do I use? Yep, exactly right. See how it goes in there. Okay? See how it goes in there like that. So, what am I going to do a draw for? What's going to be drawn? And this is a trick question. What's going to be drawn? Is it going to be sodium or chlorine? It's going to be a thinking question, I should say. What's going to be the draw? And I'll give you a hint. It's not both. It's one or the other. It's going to be cation or anion that's going to be drawn out.
Oh, man.
Well,
they're both.
What happens here is what's important, because sodium is going to combine with the sodium bicarbonate. Are you guys cool with that? NaHCO3? So what's going to be your draw over here? This is going to be really weird, but what's going to be the draw? What ions? Cations or anions? What? Well, what do I have? Things go from low to high or high to low? Okay, so they go from high to low. High concentration to low concentration. So do I have a high concentration inside the blood of a cation or anion in the basal rectum? I have a bunch of anions, so I'm going to track what?
Cations.
So let's put some cations in here. So the cations in this particular case are the same ones we had before. So what are some of the cations?
Calcium.
Potassium.
Magnesium, potassium.
Magnesium. You guys are going to love this one. What's the next one?
Potassium.
Potassium. So, mag, calcium, and potassium. Alright? Mag, potassium, and calcium. So why potassium? I pumped it out, it got back in, and then it snuck paracellular this way. Now, why would Mother Nature ever design something like that because it's gone crap? Is because potassium is a difficult one. It's difficult towards the nerve conduction, it's difficult towards heart conduction. High potassium will kill you, right? We talked about that. So here's the reason why it does this. If it gets too high, it'll lose it. Gets too low, it'll get it back. So it's kind of like think about potassium as being a floater, and it's floating between being actively through a symporter or floating back or returning passively. All right. So we kind of keep it as equilibrated as possible. Sodium in your body moves around a lot. Potassium, narrow, very narrow in terms of its concentration. All right, so I know this is a lot. The book does a horrible job explaining it. If you try to read the textbook, it's really tough. You have to read it like 3 or 4 times to have to make it sense. But hopefully I've made some sense. Because you cannot literally like describe this and have it make sense. You've got to draw it out. You've got to start here, all right, to create that draw that this hitchhikes with. Whatever, the other hitchhikers are these guys here, okay? And then this is actually the setup from here, because what we're moving is a bunch of anions. Now we're gonna move the cations, but they're gonna go across first to take the chlorine across, because we put a positive charge here. We're gonna lock up the sodium. So we're going to still create a draw for now these cations. This guy is going to come across first. We're going to lock up the sodiums. So that's a big draw now for the rest of these positives. Over here, different issue. We're dealing with hydrogen. 3 sources of hydrogen. Lock it up. Facilitate it over here. Lock up that. Get rid of that and pee that away. We can pee that away because these tubule cells, they're tough. They can withstand really big differences in pH and without getting burned. And this is actually the fine tuning. What's the name of the hormone that controls these? What is it?
ADH.
ADH will forcibly put in aquaporins into the wall here. Okay? That's your fine tuning. On the ascending loop. By the way, I think I said before, this is the toughest lecture we have. Of all the lectures we have in anatomy and physiology, this ranks up there with metabolism as being one of the. This is the toughest in 102, is these diagrams. And you can't have just a textbook, unless you're brilliant, you know, and read the textbook, oh, I got that. It took me like 20 years just to put up the diagrams myself. It took me 21 years. Let's take a break.